Returning to society after incarceration would, of course, be challenging for anyone. But the difficulties only multiply for older men and women coming out of prison. Amna Nawaz reports on the many hurdles these individuals can face after decades behind bars. It is part of our ongoing series, Searching for Justice.
How are you doing, Dr. Sophia?
I'm good. How's it going?
At the Transitions Clinic Network in San Francisco, Dr. Shira Shavit's first patient of the day is Melvin Malcolm.
So how's the fatigue been? Are you still feeling pretty tired?
Yeah, I still am.
Malcolm is 74 years old. He suffers from degenerative rheumatoid arthritis and prostate cancer.
Okay, I'm just going to take a quick listen to your heart.
Diseases he developed while serving 38 years in prison for murder and robbery. He was released just 3 months ago, and so far, life on the outside hasn't been easy.
What are some of the challenges that you're facing day to day?
Handling things on your own. Generally, incarcerated, everything is handled for you. Your medication is brought to you. You're told when to eat, you're told when to sleep. Things are more or less programmed for you. Once you come out, you have to do things on your own. And it's pretty hard to get used to doing that.
Go ahead and relax your arm for me, please.
He says the health care he's getting now is much better than what he got in prison. But nearly four decades behind bars has taken a toll.
I have the degenerative rheumatoid arthritis, as you can see by my hands, and I'm gonna have to have, I think, knee surgery. You know, and my feet are really bad.
Did anything else come up in your visits with him today?
Dr. Shavit says Malcolm is a typical patient here at Transitions, a national network of nearly 50 nonprofit health clinics that serve people post-incarceration.
Our practice here, 66% of people have done 30 or more years in the state prison system. And what we know is that people age more quickly when they're incarcerated. And so when we think of older adults, we actually think of people who are 55 and older who have been in this system.
20 years ago, people 55 and older made up just 3% of the U.S. prison population. Today, that's grown to more than 10%. One major reason? Tough on crime policies dating back to the 1990s that led to longer prison sentences.
When people come out of prison or jail, everything's kind of all up in the air at the same time. But it's even more difficult for older adults. People have been apart from the community for longer. They have less connections in the community, less social supports, and have more challenges in addressing some of their needs.
The team here at Transitions tries to step in and meet the most pressing needs, not just medical.
If that's why you have that little phone icon.
There's technology training.
How are you doing?
Help getting IDs and documentation.
They didn't put my middle name on the ID card.
And access to food.
You also got some chicken, too.
Yeah, chicken's okay, too.
A key part of this team, people who know what reentry after prison is like. People like 58-year-old Ron Sanders. He battled addiction and was in and out of prison during his 20s on drug charges.
So imagine if somebody's been locked up for 20, 30, 40 years. It's good to have somebody to help you, guide you along.
Is it your first time going to Walgreens to get the medications?
No, this is not my first time, but it's the first time I'm going to get a refill.
He's been working at Transitions for 15 years as a community health worker and spends a lot of time building connections and trust with patients often skeptical of the system.
Why do you think they trust you?
Because, you know, they know I came from the same place they came from. You know, I've been in those shoes before, you know, and I know. And I know how scary it is just getting out, you know, and especially you get out and you don't have any, like, family support or anything. It's really tough.
But for older adults exiting prison, this level of support is rare. Few clinics like this exist across the country, and the ones that do are often located in urban areas. For people who need longer-term medical care, the options are even more limited.
Being away for a while, I was really scared.
Letitia is a 67-year-old woman who suffers from mental health disorders and lymphedema, which causes swelling of the arms and legs. She served 17 years in prison for murder. She asked us not to use her last name.
I have PTSD, and I had deep depression, and I was very, very disturbed.
In 2019, she was released from prison and discharged to 60 West, a privately owned nursing home in Rocky Hill, Connecticut, with 95 beds. Opened in 2013, 60 West is funded mainly by the state of Connecticut and its Medicaid system. Many residents here are formerly incarcerated.
Being able to look anyone up and find out what their history is very easy now in our social world.
Administrator Jessica Deering says nursing homes are often reluctant to accept residents who've committed serious crimes.
Now, certainly the person could be the picture of nursing home appropriate. However, traditional nursing homes weren't giving them a chance to be a part of their community. So that's why 60 West was created, so that we could provide an environment of stigma-free living.
If this place wasn't here, where would you have gone? What were your options?
I don't know. Probably a shelter.
Letitia's story is not uncommon at 60 West. After 33 years in prison for murder, Mike Jarrett landed here in 2016. He's now 70, battling clinical depression and diabetes. His right leg was amputated from a systemic infection he got while in prison.
This place is ideal for me because it helps me get my Social Security straightened out, find a place to live, get all my medical supplies taken care of. I didn't know how much of a benefit this place would be, but it's a fantastic benefit.
People will wonder, why should all these amenities, why should a place as comfortable and as nice as this be made available to people who have committed very serious violent crimes? What would you say to them?
The only alternative to me being here is being left off in the streets. So I'm kind of blessed that way, but it's not going to last forever. Eventually this place is going to fill up again.
Jarrett's now navigating his next hurdle.
I'm stuck. My hands are tied.
Where to go now that he no longer needs this level of care? His bed is already in high demand with more older parolees.
The only reason why I am still here for the last 3 years is because I can't find an apartment. And I can't find an apartment because they apply and it says that I have a police record and they won't accept me. I am trying hard to get out of here. I certainly don't want to take up anybody else's space.
And Jessica Deering says because the cost of care inside prisons is so high, this is a more cost-effective approach for the state of Connecticut.
Having us open actually saves the taxpayers of Connecticut annually because we focus on care. So we can do it in a much more efficient manner, and ultimately it costs less money.
60 West says several states are exploring ways to replicate this model as the nation grapples with how to care for this aging population. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Amna Nawaz in Rocky Hill, Connecticut.
And our Searching for Justice series continues tomorrow with a look at one woman's fight to overcome her past and her background check.